शिवानंद शर्मा मेमोरियल आरवी कॉलेज एंड आईएसआर इनिशिएटिव। एसएसएमआरवी कॉलेज वन ऑफ द प्रीमियर इंस्टीट्यूट्स रन बाय द प्रेस्टिजियस आरवी ग्रुप ऑफ इंस्टीट्यूशंस हैज कम अप विद अ यूनिक इनिशिएटिव टू एंगेज स्टूडेंट्स एट द टाइम ऑफ दिस अनफॉर्सीन मेडिकल इमरजेंसी कॉज्ड बाय कोरोना आउटब्रेक। As a socially responsible institution, we would like to connect academically with students to make good the losses caused. In this connection, I, Sindhu Shree NS of the Department of English, have posted a video on the subject English, and this video is a revision of all the lessons for second semester BCom, and this video is part 1. Watch the video till the end, like, share with your peer groups and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you. You can find the revision for these three lessons in this video, which means part 1 of the video. You will find the revision for the poem Freedom, and you will find the revision for the lessons A Cut Above and Charlie Chaplin. Revision of other lessons you will find in part 2 of the video. For the lessons Definitions of Femininity, Masculinity, Hayavadana and Endymion, you will find full video lecture in the same YouTube channel. We'll start with the poem Freedom. It's a poem written by Rabindranath Tagore. What does Rabindranath Tagore say in this poem? In this poem, Tagore tells us that his wishes that his country should be free from the fear of British imperialism. With this, he urges the countrymen to overcome any kind of fear and oppression and liberate themselves to enjoy the bliss of freedom, the happiness that they gain from freedom. He says, he starts the poem by saying that he claims freedom from fear for his motherland. Motherland is India. Next, he tells us that he is asking for freedom from the burden of ages. By this, he means that the burden of years and years of colonialism has made India bend her head in shame. India is blind to the call of future, which perhaps means there is a sense of hopelessness that was looming at that point of time. Britishers, they came to India in the year 1600. Gradually, they started ruling India. And we were under the control of Britishers. We were under British imperialism till the year 1947. And Tagore tells us that this has made years and years of colonialism has made India bend her head in shame. Next, Tagore says that colonialism is completely passive. It is as if a ship is being steered by random winds when there is no one to control it. And poet uses the metaphor here, where he compares India to a directionless ship. He feels that helm is being driven by cold hands, which means people who are detached. Britishers didn't care what Indians were feeling or how poor India was. All they were interested was to borrow all the wealth of India, to take all the wealth of India to their own country, Britain. So the colonial rulers were least bothered about India or its progress. Now at the end, Tagore explains us that living under British is like living under puppet world. We are like those dolls, puppets, where all Indians are puppets whose strings are pulled by Britishers. Obedience has now become a mindless habit and Indians wait for their masters to give commands and they readily follow it. We always waited for our masters, Britishers, to give commands and we always followed these commands. We didn't think or we didn't bother to think what were these commands, why we were following Britishers, why we were being ruled by Britishers. We were just interested in following the commands that were given by Britishers. So this is what the poem is all about. It's a small poem. You have to just understand what are the thoughts that are expressed by Rabindranath Tagore in this poem. And I have provided you a written summary of the poem. Please go through it. Now, with this summary of the poem and explanation of the thoughts present in the poem, you should also understand the figures of speech that are used in the poem. There are mainly three figures of speech which you can see here. First one is synecdoche. What is this? What is synecdoche? Which means when a part is represented by the whole or vice versa. It is called as synecdoche. What are the examples you can take from this poem? Helm, sail. These are the examples for the figure of speech, synecdoche. What is the next figure of speech you can find? Alliteration. What is alliteration? if there is repetition of same letter, it is called as alliteration. What is the example? The first line of the poem, freedom from fear is the freedom. It is an example for alliteration. And what is one more figure of speech that you can find? Metaphor. What is metaphor? If a word or phrase is applied to an object, it is called as metaphor. What are the examples you can find? Wholesales, uncertain winds. These are the examples for metaphor. Now we will move to the lesson, A Cut Above. See, this is a story of a woman entrepreneur called as Meena Bindra. And it is written by Rashmi Bansal when she had a chance to interview Meena Bindra. This is a story. This is a story of a woman entrepreneur called as Meena Bindra. And it is written by Rashmi Bansal when she was interviewing or taking the interview of Meena Bindra. Who is Meena Bindra? We'll get to know all about her. Meena was born and she was brought up in Delhi. She lost her father, who was a businessman, when she was just 9 years old. She belongs to a city called as Delhi. And she grew up in a large family of 6 siblings, 3 brothers and 3 sisters. And she was somewhere in the middle. So her father, he passed away. He was a famous businessman and he passed away when Meena was just 9 years old. However, Meena's father, he left behind a lot of property. So her mother was able to provide and give them a normal childhood. After completing her education, what was that? What degree did she get? She got a BA degree from Miranda House. After that, after getting her BA degree, she married when she was just 19 and a half years old. What was her husband? Her husband was working in Indian Navy and he was 10 years older to elder to her. So as a Navy wife, Meena was supposed to move around all the time, all over the country, from Delhi to Bombay and sometimes from Bombay to Visakhapatnam. She never had a chance to stay or settle in a particular city or in a particular state for more than 3 years. She tells that, I never had a chance, never more than 3 years in one place. I was not able to settle in one place for more than 3 years. So after her marriage, she had 2 sons. Her elder son, Sanjay, he was born in the year 1965 and Siddharth was born in the year 1974. So what happened? The first 20 years of her marriage, she was just busy looking after home and family. She didn't care that I have a BA degree, I should go and work somewhere or I should start a business of my own. She didn't feel this. She was happy with her family. She was happy taking care of her children. What happened only when she realized, she thought of doing something as she was bored. Her eldest son, Sanjay, he was in boarding school and the younger one was going to school. So she was not interested in any kinds of entertainment or any other activity and she was not interested to go out and work. So, but she enjoyed one thing. What did she enjoy? She enjoyed designing clothes. That was her interest. And she spoke about this, her interest, to her husband and he arranged for a loan from Syndicate Bank. And what was the loan she got? What was the amount? Her husband arranged for a loan from Syndicate Bank for 8,000 rupees. With this money, she bought some fabric and she also hired a person to stitch these clothes. And with this, what happened? She calls one thing as her lucky break. What is this lucky break? She tells her first lucky break was when someone introduced her to a person called as Devesh. Who is this Devesh? He was a block printer. He was a young boy. He was passionate about his work and he had a big factory. And every morning, Meena would wake up. She would finish all her work, household chores, and she would take a cab to the factory. Which factory? To David's factory. And she would spend the day in the factory, experimenting with various techniques and color combinations. She enjoyed experimenting with new techniques of printing, tie and dye, then hand-printed kalamkari paintings. And she did all these things. Whatever she did, they came out really well. So through trial and error, Meena put together 40 salwar suits, all casual wear and reasonably priced. These were priced under rupees 200, some stitched and some unstitched. What did she do? She had a little sale in her house and everything got sold. She also got a lot of orders after this sale. So her first profit was 3000 rupees and her customers were none other than her neighbors. So this encouraged her and she bought more fabric with the profit 3000 rupees that she had gained. And after that, she employed more tailors and she started getting inquiries from even retailers. Now what happened? Her business started growing. And with this, she should take care of the accounts and other things, other aspects of business, no? So she needed a name for her bill book. So as she needed a name for her bill book, what did she do? She decided on a name. What was that name? Biba. She decided on the name Biba for her company. And as I told you people before, her business started growing really quick. Now she thought that she should have a space of her own for her company and she moved to a 1,000 square feet office at Kemp's Corner. And she was getting the rupees and this thousands grew to lakhs very quickly. And in 1986, 3 years after her company started, she moved into a 1,000 square feet office at Kemp's Corner. And she paid for this office entirely from the money she earned from Biba. Now what happened? Her elder son, he showed some interest in the company. And Meena's elder son, what is his name? Sanjay. He completed his BCom degree and he told his mother that even I want to join the company. At the initial stages, Meena was not interested to get Sanjay to her company or to the business. And even Sanjay did not show much interest. But gradually he started taking care of the company and he took care of handling the labor, taking orders, keeping accounts. These are the things which Meena didn't like. She always felt handling the labor, taking orders or maintaining, keeping accounts. These are the boring sides of the business. So who took care of these things? Sanjay. And Meena went for advanced planning. She adopted control systems and quality checks. Now Sanjay is in the business. After that, her younger son, Siddharth, he also joined the company Biba in the year 2002. He suggested that even they should have their own retail outlets. So Biba opened its first outlet in Mumbai. And Shoppers Stop and Pantaloons were also opened. They opened their new outlets and they needed more and more stocks. So they placed for orders from Biba. They liked the quality and the designs of Biba, so even Shoppers Stop and Pantaloons started placing their orders as they needed more and more stocks. So she tells that she restructured her company in the year 2006. What was this restructuring? The whole company was restructured in the year 2006. A famous business person called as Kishore Biyani, he bought 100% stake or the portion that the company owned in Biba for ₹110 crores. So she tells that her growth or the company's growth since the year 2004 is extraordinary. She admits that. And she also tells us, she gives the details of her profit. She tells that in March 2012, Biba's annual revenues stood at ₹300 crores with 90 company owned outlets which were contributing to 50% of the sales. The company continues to outsource manufacturing, but it employs around 1,000 people in supervisory roles and for retail sales. So Meena tells that she was always able to manage her personal life and business life. How did she do that? She gives the details. She tells us that she was not working under somebody. She owned the company. It was not a compulsion that she has to work overtime or something like that. As it was her own company, she used to say like 6 o'clock, 6 p.m. is my time. I have to go to home. So working or managing a business was not a problem. She was able to manage personal life and business life very well. So in the year 2010, Sanjay, elder son, Meena's elder son, he sold his stake and he started a new ethnic wear company called as 7 East. Now at the end of the lesson or at the end of the interview, Meena tells us, how she keeps her energy up. She does so much in a day, you know. She takes care of her family. She takes care of the company. There is so much that she has to do. So she tells us that to keep her energy up, what does she do? She practices yoga. She practices pranayama. She goes for walking and she likes swimming. And she also tells us that she loves reading and she is very much influenced by a book called as I Am That, which is written by Nisargadatta Maharaja. And she also gives a message to women folk. What does she say? She says a woman can be anything. She can be a wife, she can be a mother and an entrepreneur. We get to know this from the example of Meena herself. No, what was she? She was a daughter first, then she became a wife, she became a mother, after that she became an entrepreneur. So Meena tells a woman can be anything. She can be a wife, a mother and an entrepreneur. And what we have to do, or what a woman must do, she has to dream something, she has to live that dream. So she gives us a message at the end of the lesson. What is that? Live a dream and have it all. So this is the story of Meena Bindra, and this is the story of a famous company called as Viva. Now we will move to a lesson which is an extract from Charlie Chaplin's autobiography called as, the title of the lesson is Charlie Chaplin. This is an extract from the autobiography of Charlie Chaplin, who was a famous English comic actor. He was a filmmaker, a composer, screenwriter, editor and producer. Who wrote this biography? His biographer, or Charlie Chaplin's biographer, is David Robinson. So this is how the biography starts, or the extract starts. Chaplin was born on 16th April 1889 in East Lane, Walworth. After his birth, his family moved to West Square, St. George's Road, Lambeth. He took birth in East Lane, and after his birth, his family moved to West Square, St. George's Road, Lambeth. What was Charlie Chaplin's mother? His mother was working in theatres. She was an actress. And Chaplin also had an elder brother. What was elder brother's name? Sidney. Mother used to keep them under the care of housemaid, as she was supposed to go and work in theatres. And mother used to take them to Sunday excursions, and Chaplin remembers these small incidents and small details from his childhood, including trying to perform a legerdemain. What did he do one day? Chaplin's elder brother, Sidney, who was 4 years older than Chaplin, he used to perform these magics with hands. One day he swallowed a coin and he made it come out to the back of his head. So even Charlie Chaplin was very much encouraged by this. He tried to do the same thing. Chaplin swallowed a half penny and he was not able to get it from the back of his head. Obviously, mother was supposed to take him to doctor. He gives us details of these small incidents from his childhood. He gives these details and he also tells us that there were so many beautiful things in his place. But one particular thing attracted him a lot. What is that? That sixpenny toy chair that he had bought from gypsies, people who keep wandering, they are called as gypsies, that he had bought from gypsies, that gave him an inordinate sense of possession. He always felt that this sixpenny toy chair, this belonged to me. So it gave him an inordinate sense of possession. So one day he understands that mother had filed a case against her husband for non-support of her children, and she did not win the case. Because one day while he was sleeping downstairs, he was able to hear his mother talking. She was scolding somebody. She was taking the name Armstrong and she was scolding that Armstrong did this, Armstrong did that. So he gets to know that this person, Armstrong, he was their father's lawyer, and mother lost the case against the father. Now Chaplin remembers that his father was a vaudevillian, which means he was also into theaters. He was very quiet. He was brooding man with those dark eyes. So mother used to say that he looked like Napoleon, dictator of France, Napoleon. So father drank too much, though he was earning very well. Father was earning very well, but he had a problem. What is that? Excessive drinking. So this excessive drinking was the cause of their separation. Before marrying Chaplin's father, what did mother do when she was just 18 years old? She ran away with the middle-aged man to Africa. She led a luxurious life there with this middle-aged man. And Sidney, elder brother, he was born there. After she returned to England, she married Chaplin's father. And they knew each other before. They played role in the same drama. So they knew each other before she ran away to Africa. So once she returned to England, she married Chaplin's father. Everything was fine. They were leading a luxurious life after marriage. Like they had, they were able to lead their life properly, though they were not very rich. And what happened for the excessive drinking? It resulted in the separation. Even after the separation, she didn't demand any money from father to take care of her children. Everything was fine. But what happened? She had trouble with her voice. Even the slightest cold would bring her laryngitis. Middle of her singing, her voice used to crack. And when this used to happen, people who are present there, the audience, they used to laugh at her. Because of this, because of mother's vocal condition, it was not possible for her to take part in theater. Because if you want to be a good actor or actress, it is essential that you should have good voice, isn't it? So it was not possible for her to take part in theatrical activities. So it was inevitable for Charlie Chaplin to go and work in theaters, because mother used to take Charlie Chaplin every day to her performances. Charlie Chaplin grew up watching these performances. So when he was just 5 years old, he gave his first performance, and his first performance was Jack Jonas. And Chaplin started getting good amount of money from his audience for his performances. Even the stage manager of the company in which mother was working, he supported Charlie Chaplin a lot. Mother never regained her voice. She lost all the money she had saved. So mother always told Chaplin that she, though she was acting, taking part in theaters, she always felt that her life at theaters was. She used to tell this to Chaplin always. Mother started doing needlework as she was unable to work at theaters. Even this was not possible. It was not possible for her to sustain her life by doing needlework. They were reduced to poverty. Mother was developing migraine headaches, and she was forced to give up even the needlework that she was doing. So there must be somebody to take care of the family, no? So elder brother Sydney, he started selling newspapers between his school hours. One day he was selling newspapers in a bus. Who? Sydney. And he found a purse in bus which had a pile of silver, copper and gold coins. So mother exercised her religious thoughts, and finally she decided that God had sent the purse or the money as a blessing from heaven. And with this money, they went to Southend on sea for a holiday, and they enjoyed a lot. Whatever money they had got, it was all gone now. Once all the money was gone, their troubles started again. So there was no option for them. Mother never regained her voice. She lost all the money she had saved. They got a purse and they got some money. Even they lost the money that they had gained from the purse. So it was not possible for them to sustain their lives. So she spoke to so many people, and they suggested her that she, with her two children, they have to go and enter some workhouse. So without any alternative, mother decided that three of them should enter the Lambeth workhouse, and that's how their life went on. So this is all about the lesson or the extract from autobiography Charlie Chaplin. So this is just a revision. It does not mean that if you watch this video or listen to this video, it will suffice you for the for writing answers in the exam. I'm repeating, this is just a revision video. You have to read the full lesson, go through the important points and practice answer writing. Only then you can perform well in the exam. Find the revision of remaining lessons in the part 2 of the. Thank you.